Island, it was just like, you know, I mean, I've just been writing a lot of songs, you know what I mean? Like, I mean, these guys kind of like, I was able to like, kind of be more in control of my direction, you know, than like, you know, sometimes on a major label you get like, you know, I was like writing songs for like well over a year and like still kind of going like, so, direction are we going in? I was like, I don't know, I don't know anymore because the last like five directions were like, you know, I thought that was the one, you know? So, and yeah, so as a result, I've wound up with like, you know, well over, you know, like a 100 songs, and, you know, I had to, like, narrow it down to, like, 12 songs, and I'm finally thinking in terms of, like, records. Like, I used to be, like, more like, I like that song, I like that song, I like that song, and I just put anything, you know, together because I like the song, and now I'm thinking more in terms of a cohesive a
compliment
body
I think
of
that
work.
Someone gives you is, like, I never skip any of your songs.
Nice.
It's like, that's your record, I listen to the whole thing, and that's a really nice thing to hear. I'm sure any, like, artists would like to hear that, you know, because you know these songs, a lot goes into like going like, you don't just go like, fuck it, I'll put that song on the record, you know, like you pretty much go like, I need that song on the record, and when someone skips it, you know, or tells you they skip it, I mean, you know, go ahead, skip my songs, I mean, but when someone skips a song, it's like, oh, Buzzgate, an entire like a 12-inch Subway Hero at one sitting, not like the half of one, and I was like, whoa.
Dude. That's what your biggest disappointment was?
That I totally threw up afterwards. I don't know.
This is Christian, one of my writing partners, and producer extraordinaire, engineer, amazing. So.
Take me to a place.
I want to play for you, but I only have like, you know, 40-45 minutes, and you know, I've written like probably like 100 and something songs since I've seen you last, and I just had to pick 10. So fuck it, I picked what I picked, yo. But I'll be back, and I hope you'll be back too. And once again, you know, I mean, this is our last song, but it's close.
Oh, so like fucking elves and shit in there. I had to sit on Santa's lap to order a fucking coffee the other day. I think I had a boner though. Which was awesome. I stuck my donut on it. I don't know why I'm saying all this shit. I just have nothing else to say while I tune. I want to entertain you. I'm an entertainer. My name is LP. I'll be here all night. Salads are coming around. And Oscar and I'm gonna toss your salad individually. It's gonna be gross. Nobody kiss me at the end of that. Awesome. Anyway, moving right along to the actual act. This is called Good With You. I wanted to stick my finger in your drink, man. I really
have a drink too.
Yeah. I heard something dirty. So anyway, meanwhile, back at the Screaming Ranch, the song is called The Power.
Yay!
We're gonna do another show soon, but I'll get to all that shit. And again, this is an opening slot, so it's short. But! Oh, shit! I just did it to the wrong arcade. Awesome! Awesome! Yeah. So, and also, you guys.
Wait,
whoa.
Wait.
So, it's like Tourette's out there, man.
Wait, fucking wait for them. Fuck you, man.
I love you. God,
I love you.
I'm turning nightmare tonight. My guitar is a little sad. Oh! I can say whatever the fuck I want. title track off my last record, which is available for sale, along with t-shirts and buttons. Anybody want a button? Yay! Woo! All right, you! Almost, so close. Anyway.
I was like kind of shy about it. I didn't really, you know, think I was going to be a singer. And then I used to sing with like the vacuum on in the back of the car, you know. And then one day my mom said, you know, what's about that? And I just started singing, and then I just never stopped. So. I love, I'm a huge Jeff Buckley fan, Nirvana. You know, even like Led Zeppelin and stuff like that, but I love pop. I don't know, Green Day. I love Joni Mitchell. Did I say Aretha Franklin? Did I? I don't know. I'm really bad at that question. I've answered it like 100 times and I'm still like deer in the headlights. It's like influences. I have none. World domination. I just want to increase my fan base, play all a little more out there. You know, it's been kind of like small. I've reached a small fan base. What's the craziest thing I've ever had a fan do for me? Oh, I've signed some boobies.
Once I was, this guy comes up to me and goes, we were in like the Midwest somewhere, and this guy's like, he's like, my wife wants to know if you're signed one of her breasts. It's like, nice. So I'm like, all right, bring it on. So this woman comes to me, she's like rake thin, she's just like, boop, this big fake titty like pops out, and she's like, write something on it, right? And then like about like a half hour later, the guy goes up to me, same guy, is just like, my wife wants to know if you signed the other one of her breasts. So I did, but that was pretty funny. I thought that was funny. It was knocked my fucking eye out, but it was good, you know. The worst things could happen. Taxes. Nope! It's all processed for me. It's like Velveeta. No, yes, I do. Some things I write by myself, and I mostly collaborate, especially on this record. I wrote a lot of songs for this record, so I got to write with a lot of people. And, Billy Steinberg, and Desmond Child, and Matthew Gerard, all these big pop songwriters, you know. Who else? Geez, so many people. Billy Mann. I like to thank Billy Mann and Billy Steinberg and oh yeah, Desmond Child and all. I would like to thank them all. But I wrote with like, it's like, I wrote, I think I probably wrote with the grandmother, if that's possible. I don't know if she's alive.
Oh,
okay.
No, she's dead.
I'm sorry. Well, I probably.
Thank you, though.
It could have happened, you know, in another life.
In another life.
Well, lots of confusing things happen in this business. I think it was like, you know, we had ideas and they didn't gel, maybe in the end, but, you know, it was nice. The ride was nice. The whole bidding war thing was cool, you know, but it just like, it wasn't the right label, you know, just like, I think, you know, they were excited about, something and then like they try to change it, as often happens, you know. That's why I like Sobe. Let me like go into that place, because Sobe lets you be you. That's what's so nice.
And today we have a fabulous singer and musician, hey. Miss LP. Two of my favorite letters in the whole alphabet. What are the
Sweet.
Odds? Welcome to the
Man
show.
Out.
And
Thank you.
I don't think that you know yourself as well as you think you do. So I'm going to challenge you, my friend, in our competition called How Well Do You Know Yourself?
Is this some like Nietzsche?
It's Nietzsche. How do
Amazing.
You know? Exactly. Question number one, you ready?
Yeah.
What is LP backwards? Really not that hard.
Peace and love.
Peace and love. Or
it's really
PL.
Not that hard. I thought there was a hidden question there,
There's
so I was trying
hidden.
To like is, break it down.
This is a very slow person show.
Okay.
We want to.
You have your hand on my leg.
We this is very first slow.
Amazing.
People.
Well, oh.
I'm a doctor.
It's a family show.
Okay. In 2004, you did an interview with AfterEllen.com. Which of the following things did you not say? A, the rock scene is intense. B, I didn't really have a mentor help me to get into the rock scene. I just did it all by myself. Or C, I do have pockets of lesbian fans here and there.
What did I not say?
What did you not say? Read
I think I didn't say that the rock scene is intense.
You did not say that. That is true.
That's like stupid.
It's kind of douchey.
Yeah.
Oh, like, it's really intense, man.
It's like no shit.
I said that earlier today.
Oh, sorry.
No. All right. Your song Wasted was on South of Nowhere. It was a theme song.
Yes, it was. And you know what? Those two girls were on your show. They had a bed.
Are you serious?
That's all I want to say.
What do you want me to do?
That's all I'm saying.
Can we get our blow-up bed for her? Do we have it still inflated?
It's
we will
like
get
I got
you
really
blow-up
excited.
Bed. Do you want the freaking bed? Why am I not enough
I
for
want
you?
The bed
what are you,
the
my
two,
father?
With the two South of Nowhere girls in it.
Oh, that's what you
can
want.
Can we do that?
First of all, I think they're underage. No, they're not underage.
Oops.
If you had to pick one of those two girls on the show, if you had to pick between...
Oh, that's a toughie, babe.
Spencer or Ashley.
I have a
which
thing
one
for Spencer.
Date?
I really like Spencer.
You like the good girl.
I like
girl.
The good girl.
Good mm-hmm. girl gone bad. Mm-hmm. You just show up like John Cusack with the...
Gone bad!
Exactly.
Good girls.
Your song Wasted was on South of Nowhere. What year did South of Nowhere premiere on TV?
2007.
No.
2006.
Nope.
2008.
Nope. Less than
2004. 2005.
Terrible.
That's
Next
amazing.
Question.
Yes!
You don't know yourself at all. On your Wikipedia page, which two musical genres are you associated with? rock and pop, pop and alternative, or rock and indie?
Oh. Yeah. On my Wiki page?
On your Wiki page.
I think probably like, I know there's alternative in there. I'm almost positive. So I would say pop alternative.
No. You're a rock awesome. Pop girl. Did you know this?
That's awesome. I would say I'm a rock pop girl, but I feel like I felt
you're like Justin Timberlake is what I was thinking.
Yeah. Combination that's exactly what I'm like. I can't even get out of my car sometimes.
All right, so Miss LP.
Give me a good question, man. Come on.
What the? You don't like the bad. You don't like my question. I was going to ask you what your real name is because you go by LP.
I don't tell my real name.
Why not?
I don't know. It's like, why would you?
But it's public knowledge. It's out there.
You know, check out the Wiki page. Man.
Okay, I have a present for you.
I did.
You are the prettiest princess that's ever been on my show, so.
That's wrong.
No, it's not. It fits perfectly.
It's the name and then it's the tiara. Dude. You're killing me with this, no, but I'll put it on.
You look lovely.
There you go.
You
look woo! Beautiful.
Is that what you wore to prom? Did you wear a
I did.
To prom?
I wore this to prom.
Did you go to prom nothing with a boy else. Or a girl?
I didn't go to prom, babe.
Babe?
Can you put this on?
Hell yeah, I'll put this on. I'm all about
so,
that.
So
what's
it.
Coming up for you? Feels, doing any more shows?
My dinner is
dinner.
Coming up.
What are you gonna have for dinner?
it's too early for dinner. I'm not gonna have anything for dinner, but what were you gonna ask me?
Don't
about?
Eat breakfast,
what
you have dinner. You're anorexic. This is an intervention.
This
all
is
right.
An intervention.
Please check out LP's music.
The white.
Voice and with our Halloween costumes on, had a quick chat backstage.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
It's amazing watching you sing. Are you aware that you bring that kind of joy to people in a club like that?
I try to.
You gotta go out there.
Okay. Why? Oh, okay. He's messing with me. See, I know everybody so well here that like they all mess with me. I don't know. That's like my goal. I want to like bring like. I feel like I can do that. And I like doing it. I like bringing the happiness to the peeps.
It's an interesting question, but I thought about it when I watched you sing. Like, have you watched the kind of idol phenomenon around the world, X Factor and all these things? People blowing people away. How do you think, what do you think about it when you get up there and, I mean, you kill it on there?
I don't know. I like the subtlety of a lesser forum. I don't really love the whole, like, oh, man, you know, you gotta, like, I don't know. I mean, Idol is amazing and it's brought so many beautiful, amazing singers here to light and everything, and it's awesome. But I don't know, they would probably like trash me in a second. And I'm very fragile, man. I can't deal with that, you know?
Really?
I get really sad. Like, if that Simon guy fucking said something to me, I'd get all New York on him. I'd probably fucking punch him in the face.
I've got a feeling he'd actually stand up and be pretty blown away. But your story in music, at what age did you know you had a pretty special talent? What age?
I don't know. I guess, like, when I was, like, in elementary school, like, kids were always like, oh, shit.
You can sing.
Are you really singing? I was like, yeah, because I was, like, this little kind of, you know, I looked like a fucking child until I was, like, fucking 20 years old. So I just was like, you know, there was like, wow, you sing kind of, like, mature. And I was like, yeah, you know. So I,
when are we going to see you in Australia performing and letting the Aussies catch it?
Soon. I'm working with this cool kid. I'm a writer as well. I write songs. So I'm writing with this kid, Jordan Jansen, who I love, who's, like, a big phenomenon in Australia, apparently. So I don't know, like, that's my biggest contact with Australia right now, but as soon as possible, man. I want to fuck
you up. Get there. Well, the thing I love asking everybody is if they can live the ultimate dream, what it would be. What would it be for you if you could live the ultimate dream?
Me, yeah. For me, I would like to, like, tour, like, 6 months out of the year. And I would like to write songs for other people for 6 months. Because I'm a songwriter at heart. That's my thing. I've been writing songs for, like, totally random artists that you would never think that I would write for.
Really?
Yeah.
What's, like, the most random?
I have, like, the next Rihanna single coming out.
That's amazing.
That's weird, right?
Yeah.
And Christina Aguilera in that movie Burlesque. And I don't know. I write for the Backstreet Boys. I don't know. I do all kinds of weird shit.
It's quite incredible. But were you always a big dream chaser? Because you're talking about the biggest artists on the planet, and they're singing the words to your songs.
I don't... my life is a dream, man. I just want to do, like... I just, like, the dream is to do what you love doing every day and not worry about it. I'm a chronic worrier. I worry every day. But I just can't not do what... I can't not do music. I can't stop. So I'm just... I don't know. I don't know. Like, if you want to listen, listen. If you don't. It's all good.
I can say it's an amazing thing to come to a club from another country and be blown away by somebody. So great to meet you, and all the best.
Thank you so much, Andrew. I really appreciate it.
South by Southwest in Austin, and it's an amazing experience, a very busy, awesome experience. I had a lot of cool shows already. Each one gets better for me, because the first one was like, get off an all-night plane ride, sleep for 3 hours, and then jump up in front of a crowd and be the guinea pig for the sound. And that was weird, but that's what playing live is all about. I feel like I missed that. I haven't, like, done, like, show after show for a little bit. It's always, like, getting used to, like, the rat race of, like, these live shows, because honestly, playing live is one of those things that, like, you just never know what you're gonna get. You know, sometimes the sound is bad, sometimes the time slot is bad, you know, and a lot of times it's good, or it's like, you never know about the crowd. It's just one of those things that you have to roll with, and you know, kind of not get too focused on, you know, one show. But I do. I do. Just love music here. You know, you could make a living and be in Austin doing music and playing music in Austin, and you know, the outside world might not know you sometimes, but a lot of people come out of here and come here to make music and hang out and chill out. I heard that Robert Plant's here now, which is good enough for me. If he's here, it must be cool. Kimmer's amazing. Like, I can't believe, like, the scope of everything she does. It's like, she's like a wild animal in the songwriting respect. It's really cool. And Gary
Joaquin is just like a maniac. You know? He's just like, he walks on stage and you're just like, whoa, you know, like you're meeting like some icon from the 60s and 70s. It's really cool. So I enjoyed meeting him. A few years ago, I got signed out of South by Southwest with this bidding war. I had my first major label deal ever, and that was like quite crazy. And then I spent the next like 3 years signed to labels and not playing at all. Turned out to be a great thing, because that and another like year and a half of having a publishing deal and writing songs for other people, I've been in like songwriting school, you know, and it's been great. I think that's why I'm here now, because I went to songwriting school and kind of learned a bunch of stuff. There's always something to learn about writing songs, I would imagine, you know, I think, I don't know, I mean, maybe some people just start off right away writing great songs or whatever. Not to say that I'm writing great songs, I would never say that I wrote a great song, but I aspire to write a great song. Somebody left the gate open, you know we got lost on the way. I never know what people are thinking, you know, when I'm performing, because everybody receives music differently. Like, you know, I think I see them like responding well, but like I never, sometimes I just don't know what they're gonna say or think after. And every time I'm here, it's been like a really nice response after, and people have been like, you know, saying all nice and stuff, and it's been cool.
I think both. I mean, I feel lucky enough to be, it's like, I don't think a good singer or a great singer is any of those, is either of those things without a great song. You know, I think that the song, it's an absolutely, you know, I guess symbiotic relationship, would you call it, something like that. It's just like, it absolutely, they need each other, and I think that I'm blessed to be able to express the song, and it's, you know, it how I want, you know, like I know some songwriters that don't sing, and I'm sure it's very fulfilling for them too, but it's also very fulfilling to be the person that like communicates the song to actual people, which is pretty cool. I'm lucky.
An indie deal, you know, I put out a record, my last record was 2004, but I was touring for like 2 years on that, like indie style, you know? And then I got a major label deal in 2006 with Island Def Jam. I wrote like 135 songs or something like that. But no record came out. It just like didn't work out, you know? Like it just like, we went in a few different directions and it just wasn't, I don't know, it just wasn't like clicking right with that label. And then I started being a songwriter, because a bunch of those songs got picked up by other artists. I started writing songs for other people, and I thought that was like where I was going. I was kind of liberated by that, I thought, you know, because all the years as an artist was like, you know, it didn't really, like I didn't get to put my record out. It was a little bit liberating to have songs with other people and have them take them somewhere. And then sort of playing the ukulele and stuff, and just like being very off the cuff with my stuff, like enjoying it, you know. I got new management and they were very embracing of me as an artist. They wanted me to like start singing again for myself. And I was a little reluctant, because I was like, tried to, you know, like maybe it's not, you know, meant to be for me. Like, no, you should just try it again. And it's hard sometimes, I have to say. It's not as easy as I thought, like, because I hadn't really done that. Like, because I was writing for me, and then I started writing for other people. I could hang out in the wings a little bit more and be more observational. You know, it's like sometimes it's probably like when you give your friend advice and you give them this great advice and they're like, yeah, yeah. And then your life is a shambles and you're like, can't like pull yourself out of your own mess, you know. So I feel like maybe songwriting is a little like that for me sometimes with my stuff. I have to like fight to get to the center of myself to like write for me more. Finding like the unadulterated truth of yourself, you know, in a poetic, artistic way.
Once in a while, I can't find words to a melody, like not proper words that like give it that fit the tone and the meaning of the melody for me. But most of the time, I get a melody and then like words come. Or my favorite is when the words and the melody come at once, and then I can build the concept. That's nice.
mercy. I will come to you blind. What you see is the worst me, not the last of my kind. Oh, in the muddy water we're falling. Oh, in the muddy water we're crawling. Hold me down, hold me down, so.
I guess I want their impression that it just, it hit them, you know, that they can tell that it's genuine, I guess, you know, that they, whether they like it or not, that there's a quality to it that is of a certain level that's, that they get it, you know.
Hi, LP.
Hello.
How are
Buongiorno.
You?
I'm good. I'm good.
What about Italy? You have a bond with your Italy? Family in Italy, and now you're in Italy. So it's the first time for you here, or you have just been here in Italy?
Four times, it feels like, I think. And my family is from more southern Italy. My mom's parents were from Naples, and my dad's father was from Palermo. So, yeah, I mean, and, you know, when you grow up American Italian, everyone's very proud of that, you know, and everyone, you know, we eat only Italian food and we, like, you know, very much celebrate being Italian, even though we don't speak the language, which is funny. It's beautiful to be here, and I feel somehow like a familial feeling of warmth.
What about your inspiration for the songs you wrote, other people? Maybe love can exist without cheating?
Well, yeah, I think it can, you know, and I've learned the hard way that that's kind of the only way I want it, you know. It's like, if you're just gonna, you know, if you're gonna cheat, you might as well just, you know, kind of like be an adult and end it and, you know, just do what you want. It's not, doesn't, it hurts you almost as much as it hurts them, I think, but like the actual hurting the other person is, I think, has a lot more longevity in like how you feel about yourself later. But yeah, other people is kind of about, my ex wanted to like have an open relationship and I really didn't because I was like in love and, you know, but I said okay, because I just figured, you know, why not? Like, maybe I've never done that, so
let's try.
Maybe, yeah, maybe that's the answer to like not getting tired of each other, not getting sick of you, you know. And then you know, and then I tried it, and then I actually met the person I'm with now that I'm like in love with. So it's dangerous. And then my ex was upset that, you know, I made it like I did something wrong. I'm like, you wanted us to do this. It's like, you know, so I just think, yeah, I think very, you know, there's very few people or very few relationships that can handle, you know, not being, and I don't really see the point.
How the process of writing starts for real?
It starts with collecting like little pieces of songs, like with Lost on You. That title came to me, and I had like these three chords on the ukulele when I was on tour, in the back of the van or something like that, you know. And I just like I recorded that, and I wrote down Lost on You, and I just like I kind of constantly collect stuff like that, like melodies, like, you know. I did that like with other people, and I'm just always like kind of collecting them, and then I get like kind of more structured. I enjoy, because I don't really like homework, you know.
What were your first steps in music business?
It was difficult, honestly, because I put together a band when I was, you know, in New York. I went on tour, just like, we call it DIY, which is like do it yourself. And I just, you know, I had a manager that like,
you know, started helping us pay for like to like go around the country and play. And I don't know, I just got noticed for like some songs and singing, and then I signed to a major label in like 2006, and I was on in the major label system for about 3 years till 2009, and I wrote like 140 songs or something like that in that time. But I never put a record out, like a record never came out. I got dropped, and then I got a deal as a songwriter. And also one of my songs went to the Backstreet Boys or something like that, you know, so it got a little bit of...
I know, I'm a big fan
of
Backstreet Boys and Umbrella.
Yeah. And Love Will Keep You Up on that, yeah. And it just kind of like kickstarted me writing songs for other people. And I was kind of amazed that I could write that many songs, you know, that I was able to like kind of go in, day out and just write a song, even if it wasn't great.
You know, you have to confront with the success of Lost on You. Mm-hmm. When I hear Lost on You every time, I have to sing it all day long.
Yeah.
So how does it feel?
It's hard to feel it when it's happening in a way, but when you're feeling that connection on a large level, it's beautiful. I mean, it's what I think every songwriter strives for, and I'm very like aware that like, you know, it's a big deal to get to have a song like this, and I'm grateful and psyched, you know.
So at the end, can you say that the when you don't have a success in a relationship, you can write a big song maybe?
I think so. I think people want to see the up and down. Like I have, you know, I believe that, you know, fans go through their own up and downs, and they like to see an artist that they liked in both places, you know, because that's what life is all about.
What about your future? Maybe a tour here in Italy?
I hope so. I would love to just tour all of Italy. I swear to God, I would love to get in a bus and just like go to every single city. I think I'll be back in March or something like that too.
Wonderful. Thank you very
much. Thank you. You're the best.
Vi salutiamo. Ciao.
Hallo ihr lieben Leute da draußen, ich sitze hier heute mit einer wunderbaren Künstlerin, und zwar LP. Und ja, ich bin sehr froh, dass sie heute hier ist, weil ich die Musik ziemlich cool finde, und deshalb reden wir jetzt einfach mal über Musik.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Is that your real name?
It is, it's my real initials, that's
okay.
For sure.
So you want to be called LP, or you want to be called...
I do, I mean, my name is Laura Pergolizzi, but like, Laura is just not my name anymore, because
okay,
I've been
so
being called LP for so long.
Cool.
Feels right.
So let's talk about music a little bit.
All right, let's do it.
When did you... that's like a pretty ordinary question, but when did you notice that you want to write music?
I don't know, you know, it came upon me in such a weird way, because I came from a family that was primarily an academic family, and it's just like what we were like kind of like raised to do. So mm-hmm. Songwriting, I mean, I didn't have any clue I was ever gonna do that. And my mom passed away when I was a teenager, and she was a singer, an opera singer, and I don't know, I just was really into singing, and songwriting was just like a mystery to me.
Okay.
This is like one of those things that like seems so mysterious, and I had no like where did, and I could tell like when I talk to people now who don't do it, they have a similar thing, like they don't understand how you can just like sit down and write a song. And I think I felt like that too, but I just, you know, started singing, started playing guitar, and I still don't really know how it's done.
So it was
to be
like a self-teaching process.
Yeah.
Something like that. You wanted to do it, you started to, and it got
better. Yeah, like autodidactic.
So did you get some kind of musical education then, or did you just like...
I studied voice. I started studying voice just because I wanted to. My mother was like kind of, I think she saw from an early age that I was very like loud. I just needed to learn how to control my voice.
So you studied classical. Was then.
I studied opera for a couple of years, and it was more about like, it really all came down to scales, like you know, like we sang some arias and stuff like that, but it was more about like doing scales. And then when I started studying with like other rock teachers, really they never like told me how to sing, they just kept giving me like really cool scales, and I did them like a guitar player basically, you know.
You have
and
to
then
learn your instrument, right?
Yeah. And it really, I just did it so I could, my first band, where I was like, felt like I was like screaming a lot, like not screaming, but like really wailing out rock wise, you know, it helped me to keep my voice. And then as a result of like doing them, like really, I was very disciplined about it for some reason, just cause you know, otherwise I couldn't really sing.
Hmm.
And as a result, it just kept making me better. And I was like, oh, I can get higher and higher and stronger. So I think that was the best thing I did, really.
Okay. Was Was there a certain point where you were like, okay, now I've found my voice, that's it, that's how I want to sound, or are you still in the, because I'm a singer too, and I still have the thing that when I listen to my songs, I'm like, I'm very critical with myself all the time, you know, and
You can change, I think you can change it, like, I call it like a channel on, like, you know, do you play guitar at all?
Yeah.
Okay, so, like, and electric guitar, you go through an amp, and there's, like, different channels, you know, you could go through, and you could play through pedals and dirty channels and all that stuff. I feel like that is something I do vocally. Like, sometimes I've changed a song that I thought maybe I'd, like, pitch to someone else. Mm. I'd be like, let me just change how I sing that. Because I'll do this thing, I'll put on this, like, pop, you know, I'll put on this like pop filter on my voice and it just sounds like some, it doesn't sound like me really, you know, and because I do a lot of writing for other people, I kind of like sometimes can get in that mode, but I kind of figured out that like a song can be saved. It's the way you sing it and you have different sounds inside of you. And I think that, you know, you can get into that. So that's what I do.
I gotta be honest, like when the people here told me, okay, there's this singer coming to the show, I didn't know who LP was. But then I found something on Facebook that was like a big advert of like, okay, this is the new smash hit, like taking over Europe. And I never watched it because usually I don't watch like the mainstream stuff, which is promoted there. And then they told me that it's going to be you and you're going to be here. So I was like, okay,
I have to watch it now.
And I was so amazed. I was like, finally, there's a girl, there's a woman who is not like wrapped up in a bunch of glitter and makeup and stuff and is flying over the crowd, you know, it's like, all that stuff that I really cannot connect with. And I ended up watching your stuff all night and I was like, what, this is really, I'm sorry, but it's something new and it's something different. And
that's cool. Nice. That must have been weird because like I do the same thing when you see something that's mainstream and you're like,
you know, it's just like, you know, sometimes you might be surprised, but most of the time, unfortunately, you're not. So it's great to have you here because there's a lot of girls who are actually still thinking that when you have to be, when you want to be a successful girl, you have to do certain things and you have to look a certain way. And
I think we all have that, you know what I mean? And hopefully it's getting more and more diverse. But, you know, there's examples before us, you know, and I can't stress it enough that the most important thing you can give the world is to be exactly who you are.
Yeah, exactly. You know?
Fierceberg LP!
Hello, Berlin. I love me a good pop star.
Of course, you know, and like, they're great.
Sometimes
pop
it's really fun
there.
To see like this confectionery kind of like, wow, like, you know, like, what is that? Yeah. You know, like almost like this cartoonish example of like perfection that you're like, huh. You know, so I hate to like cast aside, you know, because one of the things I think I've learned in you know, in doing this, even, you know, as up to what I have, is that none of these people are an accident. They all work insanely hard.
Of course.
You know, even the most, you know, sugary, perfect little button of whatever, you know, of pop is like kind of like they have to do all this stuff to get there. The thing that I feel worse about are the people that don't make it that are like needed and molded and prodded and then told, you know what, you're not original or you're not enough. I've let that happen to myself musically, you know, a few times, and because you're really at the mercy of some of these people that are like, I don't want to vilify them, but the you know, they're just trying to get their bottom line and their thing. But ultimately it's your responsibility to get yourself out there intact, and I hope that, you know, myself and a bunch of other people can like give people hope, you know.
I'm sure you do. Do you think that the internet and all the technique stuff and all the possibilities are making it harder or easier for artists to?
That's a really good question. I think every age brings its difficulties. I mean, it's quite amazing that like anybody could like make a video of us and make a song and like chuck it out there. You know, that brings us back to what we were just talking about, is that like people can get through more unscathed and more like true to themselves when they can do it themselves and like just throw it on YouTube. I think it's, you know, it's gonna go ebb and flow always, like there's good aspects about it, there's bad, you know,
always the same. Cool, so now let's talk about this EP and the two songs you're gonna perform today. Could anybody even
survive it? Yeah, it's a 5-song EP, and I'm gonna do Lost on You and another song. And I actually have a record coming out. It's the 5 songs from the EP and then new 5 songs. So
okay.
That should be fun.
but I'm not gonna play any of those yet today.
Okay,
but
what's the name of the other song?
Death Valley. It's the name of the EP.
Well, you guys enjoy her on stage, and
what do we do? Like, what do you just get up and leave the scene?
No, well, we could do that. I can say goodbye to the people. Well, she already left me here, but
so long. Nope, just kidding. I'll come back.
You can say Auf Wiedersehen.
Auf Wiedersehen. Auf Wiedersehen.
And a perfect German.
Good night.
Au revoir. Oh, the whistling. We didn't talk about the whistling.
What do we need to talk about? Is whistling.
But you whistle so nice.
How do you, but like, so you're like, so how do you whistle? I don't know. How do you,
then
you know,
do it.
How do you do an armpit solo?
You know how I whistle? When I whistle on my record, it sounds like shit, and we need to put a lot of effects on it.
You know what happens? Like too much air. You gotta do both in and out. And you gotta, and then you,
now,
and you gotta turn your head to the side, because otherwise the mic picks up all that air.
Yeah, I know that.
There you still. Go.
Yeah. Okay, thank you for that.
Thank you.
That was fun.
Cool. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Me and LGBT?
Yes.
Q?
IQ?
IQ. I mean, to me, it's like a fish in the water, you know? It's like I wouldn't be anywhere else. You know, I feel very kind of comfortable in my own skin. It took, you know, some time and some work to get here, and I think, you know, really through trying to live my own life, and you know, I hope that I can be an example to people that are younger and scared or not feeling confident that, like, you know, this kind of thing is waiting for you. You know, you can be this, or, you know, be even better, be more, be different, be you. I think, you know, I'm just like, I don't try to hang out with LGBTQ people or not hang out with them. I just live, and I feel like, you know, my life is like full of all different kinds of people. I enjoy diversity, and you know, I think I'm just so in awe of all the brave people. You know, I feel like, you know, trans is such the new frontier of, you know, the movement, and it's so incredible to see how brave people are, and just, you know, people becoming their truest selves. It's beautiful. I love it.
So, yeah. We were talking now about your new album, and it's quite personal.
Yeah, I mean, it's therapy, and it's just life, you know? It's like, I mean, you want me to talk about going to, like, the supermarket, you know? Like, when I bought some, you know, mangoes, you know, I don't know what the hell to
mangoes.
Say. Yeah. I love me some mangoes, but yeah, I think it's like one of those, you know, I tend to gravitate toward the emotional aspects of life, and also, you know, I mean, not all the songs are negative, but, you know, I have a real penchant for steering toward the negative. Like, I could have, you know, I could have a magical evening, and, like, one thing was, like, a little bit, you know, fucked up, like, that I didn't like, and I'll be like, you know, like, I'll really go in on that, and I'll go to sleep, like, thinking about that thing, and everyone's like, it was a magical night. What's wrong with you? Like, what are you, you know? And I can't help it. Like, I get, like, I think I'm, like, an emotional perfectionist. is that something? I don't know. Yeah. Like, you know, I'd been on this major label for, like, 3 years. Two different major labels. On the Def Jam and Universal. And I wrote, like, you know, 140 songs or so, and one of those songs got picked up by the Backstreet Boys, and I never thought that
it was the first one.
Yeah. And I was like, wow, like, it can happen. Like, I didn't write, you know. And I remember that that session was very, very memorable, because after we finished that song, it's called Love You Keep You Up, We'll Keep You Up All Night,
I got a phone call. We were starting another song, and my father died. So that's like in my brain forever, obviously. So it was just so weird to me that that could happen, you know, that like you could, that my father could die, and also that, you know, you could write a song that was like so, you know, personal to you and was meant for you, and then it gets with someone else. And I, you know, I think that's really amazing, and I think to me such an honor to be like, to have someone that's already up and established, no matter, you know, who they are, to like kind of say like, hey, I relate to that, I want to sing it, you know, because I think singers are very, in their own way, you know, left to their own devices, very discerning. Like, it's hard to sing a song that you don't want to sing, you know, like when I do a cover, it's so difficult for me because I, like, there's a bunch of things at work. It's like, do I want to, you know, do I sing this well? Do I sound good singing it? Am I honoring this song that this person wrote by singing it this way? And does it, you know, do I feel it, you know? What a fucking bass that guy's got.
Hi.
What's up?
You're the first guest we've had with the new carpet.
Yeah. I like that.
Good for a radio show. Hey, to talk about the carpet right
Fantastic.
Off the bat.
Fantastic. Yeah, yes, let's talk about it.
That's what they say. That's what they say good content is.
My life is a carpet.
I think to think so, too.
Yeah.
When you first started out, like 20 years ago, 20-odd years ago, what career did you have in mind?
I didn't know. I mean, I didn't have any... I didn't guess that I was going to make it, to be honest.
Yeah.
I didn't. I just was like kind of doing my thing, just trying to figure out what, you know, grew up in a family that values academics, you know, over everything else. And being a doctor or a lawyer was like, you know, the version of success that I was fed.
Yeah.
And so I think I couldn't wrap my head around anything else, you know. I remember my dad said something about, you know, you can't make a career out of being an entertainer for the most part.
Yeah.
And that's really stuck with me. Like, it was like something that I was always like, oh, you can't do that.
Is it kind of fueled you?
No, it just kind of made me think, yeah, you can't do that. You know, you got to be careful what you say to kids. You know, that's
he's kind of right, is what you think. It's challenging.
I guess, yeah. I mean, no, I guess I thought maybe he's right, and I, you know, I didn't really know. I just didn't want to be told what to do, to be honest with you, by him or kind of anyone else.
I get it.
But especially him, because I didn't think he seemed that happy, you know. So his version of life did not seem so successful to me.
Yeah.
But I didn't know what was successful, you know. I don't think I didn't really trust anyone's view of success, to be honest.
When you were writing songs for, like, I mentioned the Rihanna song and the Cher song, but, like, you know, when you look through all the songs you've written, all the placements you've had, there's an awful lot of them. Is it challenging to do that and try to get your own music out at the same time? Or even write for yourself,
well,
too?
Well, I mean, you have to know how it happened. I mean, I got my first major label deal in 2006.
Yeah.
And I was introduced to a lot of big songwriters, you know. It was Island Def Jam. And, you know, I was being, you know, fed the idea that I could, you know, would be a big pop star or whatever, you know. I didn't know what was in store or whatever, but I was moving all around with different songwriters, writing with them for my record. But what I really loved was that I got all this, you know, I got to write with these people who were successful songwriters and absorb their whatever, you know, their essence. And so at the end of, and then, you know, I got a deal with an indie through a major through Sony. So it was like 3 years basically banging around in the major label system. And I wrote like in the area of like 130, 140 songs, mm-hmm. you know, it was just like a lot. And what I learned about myself then is that I had the, you know, I could be prolific. Like I could go in a room and just like cry on command and kind of do this kind of stuff. So I did. And And then at the end of it, but they were pushing me in all different directions. I didn't have a strong management at the time, so I was a bit rudderless, and I was like, and they were like, oh, let's go in this rock direction, let's go in this pop direction, yeah, let's go yeah. in this folk direction. So I just, but, you know, it was frustrating at the time, but also just, you know, convoluted. I didn't know where I was going. I just was like following what they said because I didn't know any better, you know?
Yeah.
And honestly, even when you know better, it's very difficult not to, like, to navigate the system, yeah, a major label system.
Yeah.
So after the 3 years, then nothing, it bore no fruit. Like, there was not an actual record that came out. But I had all these songs, and one song called Love Will Keep You Up All Night was cut by the Backstreet Boys.
Mm-hmm.
And that was like a watershed moment for me where I felt like, oh, that can happen. That's interesting.
Is it like a validation?
Yes, especially since, like, you know, coming up as an indie artist, one of the walls that I always hit was that, like, yo, you don't have the songs to get through. You don't have the songs. You don't have the songs. So then when I became a songwriter, the irony was, you know, not lost on me at all. I was like, oh, that's interesting.
turns out I have the songs for everybody else.
Yeah, like, you know, it's like never getting a date and then being a porn star. You're like, oh, right. Just kidding. Anyway, so I think making even a living at music was kind of like, oh my God, you know, like, and you know, getting deals was like, you know, becoming my thing, you know, and living off those deals. So, you know, at the end of the 3 year period of the major labels, I got a publishing deal with Primary Wave that's now absorbed by BMG. But they gave me another deal for songwriting, kind of based off like the music I had and the fact that I got this cut with the Backstreet Boys, and then I became a songwriter. And I, you know, I kind of stayed in California, kept like using those contacts and more to songwrite. And I just instinctively knew that I needed to write as many songs as possible and as many genres as possible in order to like make a living, especially in light of the fact that streaming was in its infancy.
Did you still want to perform? Was that still on the...
I was in survival mode at that point.
Right.
I was like, who's going to get... I'd had two indie deals before that.
Yeah.
So I was like... I'm going to get another deal? Doubtful.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's like two indie deals, two major label deals, no, you know, forward movement as far as, you know, getting known as an artist. So it's like, you know, I'll be a songwriter. Screw it. This way I don't have to worry about, you know, I could become Jabba the Hutt. Nobody cares. You know, it's just like the image is not important.
Yeah. You can wear sweats all day, everything would be like, kind of like being,
I don't really
kind
do
like
that.
Being a radio host. I know what you mean.
Exactly. So you look like crap, by the way.
I really do. I got to tell you. I didn't help it. I wore four toques at the same time, and my Star Wars pajamas today didn't help. There's a hole in both shoulders.
I wish you had Star Wars pajamas.
I wish I owned Star Wars pajamas.
Yeah, right.
So what's the turning point?
Would you ever get laid? I don't think so.
Probably not. No. Or by weird people.
Yeah.
When do you, when does it all change? Like, when does it happen? Is there a turning point?
Oh, God. Well, yes. I think, you know, when I became a songwriter, when I bought a ukulele, because I was just like, you know, fun. It was like, you know, the musical version of Star Wars pajamas for me. And I just like took off and I loved it. And I learned all these songs. And
I love that, by the way.
Yeah.
I love that you write on ukulele.
Yeah, I mean, you know who wrote on ukulele that I was like, that I found out way after that I thought was cool, was Sam Cooke.
Yeah.
Which I was like, oh, wow, that's really cool.
Well, you kind of, I mean, I don't want to say you have to go with gut, but I feel like you can't.
It's just an informal instrument.
Yeah.
You know, it's like kind
of
like.
Can't overthink it, maybe?
Yeah, and you kind of like lull the, you know, the forest animals out of the log, you know. They're like, oh, look, you know, like, they're not scared. Like, that's my thoughts. They come out of the log when I'm like playing ukulele, as opposed to like unlocking the guitar, which is like, I feel like they all run back inside.
Yeah.
When you whip that out at a session, you know, it's like, because then everyone's like, oh, so we're going to write on guitar.
Mm.
Ukulele, it's just like, it's kind of like, you know, the, you know, I don't know. It's like a Hawaiian shirt or something like that.
Right.
You're just like kind of amused by it, but it could be a fashion statement.
So you write on ukulele. You write a song that kind of turns things around for you.
I write Into the Wild and a few other songs that are just like you know, Forever For Now and Tokyo, and like it just opened the door in my heart back to the love of music after I'd been through kind of you know, what people would consider the ringer. I didn't think of it as the ringer at the time. It was just my life, you know. Mm-hmm. It was just like, hey, you have a really good voice. We want to sign you. Let's write a bunch of songs and mm-hmm. then never get an album out.
Right.
So I just like, but I was just enjoying myself again. And I remember, distinctly remember when I was a writer and I was starting, people starting to spiral or like starting to like come around me mm-hmm. again as an artist. Mm-hmm. It was because I was having so much fun just being a writer and playing ukulele and writing songs.
Well, let me ask you this then. You know, a good friend of mine, Jim Cuddy, he's in this band called Blue Rodeo. I don't know if you know them, but they're like a very big Canadian band. Like, you know, a big,
I'm not familiar. I'm
so
sorry.
They didn't really become super successful till he was around 30, 31. Mm-hmm. And he said he was incredibly grateful because had he gotten successful when he was 17, he would have had a really hard time with it. Do you feel like that? Like when you're able to do the rooms you want to do now, when you're able to play the shows?
Oh, yeah, the appreciation factor. It's so nice to be able to appreciate and enjoy things in real time because, you know, I wrote with a lot of artists. I wrote with so many artists that were like so young. And by the time not even that young, you know, for everything from like, you know, 18 to 30. And just by the time they were appreciative of it or were like, oh, wow, that was pretty cool. It was done.
It was done.
It was over.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, because you get so, they either think it's going to last forever or you don't, you know, or you listen to all these people, you know, like I had the like set spike happen several times, you know. It's like, you're amazing, you're fantastic, you're gonna be huge. Why we don't even know how big you're gonna be. You could be huge indie or actually huge.
Oh, yeah, right.
And then it's just like, or you could be sitting in your living room with nothing.
Star Wars pajamas.
You know, yeah, with Star Wars pajamas and a bar shift that starts at 5.
Yeah, exactly.
You know,
right.
I don't, it's not a very easy you know, headspace to navigate. And I think when you do get it, when you're like more mature or not even, I think it's more like your experience. I think everything that matters to me in this business is one of the biggest things is my perspective. That's something I wouldn't trade for the world, you know? Like if they said like, you know, you couldn't go back 10 years or you can go, you could erase your memory and just be the biggest star
what
in the world.
What you were promised to be, yeah.
Yeah, and I don't, it's really about like, you know, the music and the bass. Like my, you know, like having a foundation is like really important, you know, and it feels really good and just like, I don't know, right.
Can you take me through we're going to end on a song here. We're going to go on the title track from Dreamcatcher. Can you take me through Dreamcatcher?
Well, Dreamcatcher is a few years old. I was, you know, going through my last breakup and it came out of that moment. You know when you're formulating in your subconscious or like just that edge of the subconscious leading to the conscious of like that this is over, you're breaking up and it's like a very lonely kind of kind of faltering around in the dark kind of place. And that song, that's like, I feel like it just was a poem that like fell out and I was trying to play this guitar that was broken and out of tune in this studio. It was pretty apropos of that moment. And then I just did it with this guy, Chris Loco in England. And we just like, he started playing the guitar like on piano. And and that song just fell out. And it's this album, there's like three songs that were around for a while. And that's the thing that's cool. That's why I also enjoy just writing constantly because you just never know where a song's going to land. Like I tell people that when I had Lost on You, by the time Lost on You was like, killing it overseas, I was already like 30 or 40 songs away.
Right.
I'd already written 30 or 40 more songs. And because people, you know, I get this like thing in, you know, name the country and they'll be like, so you must have known that Lost on You was going to be a huge. No. I was like, I actually got dropped from Warner Brothers after I played it for them.
That's how, no albums work that way. No,
yeah.
I mean, these things, that's the funny thing when people come in to promote their records, they're always a few, they're always about 2 years removed from the pressing questions I have about the songs they just wrote.
Yeah.
It's so nice to meet you, by the way.
You too.
Hi, I'm LP, and you're watching Bobby Mee.
Dreamcatcher, I can't see you waving the light low. Slow winter, and I feel my head left out in the cold.
welcome back to Latvia. This time you brought us your new album, Heart to Mouth. Could you say the name of the album has a symbolic meaning?
I feel like it was a very direct meaning, meant to be, particularly direct, just the feeling from going from my heart right to my mouth as far as my feelings, my emotions, what I wanted to say, and that it just felt like that it was, for the most part, an honest, although, shrouded in more of a poetic stance at times, but, a lot of honesty, I guess.
It's a brave thing to do, actually, to put out yourself like that and let others inside your own world. Could you say that you're used to it now, or it still maybe sometimes scares you to be honest and put your lyrics in the songs?
I mean, it doesn't sometimes scare me. It doesn't scare me with fans at all, because I feel like they can appreciate it and they're like removed. But it scares me a little sometimes with my, people around me that I might be, culling my information from, stuff like that. But no, I think, that's your job, for yourself as an artist, I think, is to try to be, as honest as you can with yourself.
The sound of your album is quite different. There are songs that will make us dance, there are songs that kind of make us cry, and then there's some guitar, like more rock feeling. Did you have any concept before you started to write the album, or you just went with the flow and saw what happened?
I do go with the flow a lot, I try, to honor whatever is coming out. I think there's this weird balance I find for myself as far as not forcing whatever's coming out to come out. And I do think that this has more of a rock element to it. I feel like, when you come and see my show in a live way, I have like a kind of like a rock singer, kind of attitude or like soul in a way. And I've always had that, I veer into pop. I think, being a writer has made me, for other people, has made me, eclectic in a way, but then it brought me back to myself, and I like to mix it up.
And how do you write the lyrics for the songs? You go on the street and they just pop up like that, or you go maybe to some special place?
I'm always collecting lyrics, so like they pop into my head at the weirdest times, and then I have them in my book or whatever, and that's I find the best way. I think that just to collect these things, because I don't remember half the time. And then sometimes when I'm doing melodies, when I'm just writing a song, a lyric will pop out, and I feel like I write the fastest from a concept. If I figure out what I want to talk about, then suddenly I just like everything starts flying,
And in this album, is there a song that is special for you, or maybe has an interesting backstory?
Let me think. Sometimes there's like a song like Dreamer. I wrote that, very much for someone else, and then they didn't use it, or didn't fit into their record or somehow. And I felt like it was like kind of, it was more about me when we were writing, and I felt like I thought I might have been even like pushing this concept on her. Like, she was cool with it, but and she's doing great on her own. She's a really great singer. But she didn't use it, so I used it, and it was like, why not?
You have a song special in your album. Tell me, what are the things that are special for you in your world and life?
That song is about a friend of mine who was murdered in Mexico City. A really good friend, very close, and it was just about, he was, not in hindsight, he was special at the time, and it was just, it's just about, I felt really happy that, because I can't force a song like that, I've had friends or, people die in my life, and you just don't, if it happens, it happens. So I felt like that song like just came down, and it was really nice.
And what do you like to do outside of creating music? What are your hobbies and things that you love?
I really like to hang out with friends a lot. I like to do yoga and stuff like that. I don't really, like seeing my friends and family and my partner is like the biggest thing, because I'm always gone. So, and hanging out with my dog, like kind of peaceful stuff, going checking out some nature or whatever, you know, reading boring stuff, you know, but yeah, drinking with my friends, that's a good one. Yeah.
And imagine you could interview someone, any living or someone in in past, who would you interview and what would you ask them?
I would say probably Jesus Christ and be like, what actually happened? Are you a party guy, good guy, you know, just everybody loved you, I'm sure, like, but what really happened?
Do you have any observations about the world today, and maybe there are some things that you think should be talked more about?
You know, I just think that human rights in general is just something we just have to keep, you know, pushing for, like diversity and human rights and the right to be who you want to be, you know, as far as how you present yourself to the world. It's everyone's basic human right to, you know, live with dignity and clean water and food and all that. And I think that's the biggest thing I want to push for in my life, you know.
That's inspiring. And your fans, they're like super devoted and such a big fan base. And I've been to your gigs and I've seen how, like, from the first song, the energy level is so high. Like, it's not usually in every gig. How do you manage that? How do you keep that energy being on maximum all the time?
I don't know. You know, I think I get a lot from the crowd, and I just kind of, I feel like that. I always want to start like that. Like, you know, I try not to... you know, the worst thing to hear for me as a performer is like, yeah, by the, it seemed like it really kicked in by the seventh or eighth song. It's like, you know, I feel like people, you know, I'm very honored that people spend their time and money to come and see me. So I try to just give them the best show that they can possibly hope for.
If you could give a message to your fans or everyone out there, what would you say to people?
Just be nice, be kind. Be a decent person, other people. That's all.
I think I'm dealing with it okay. You know, I'm so lucky. I've had, you know, no sickness myself, and people around me haven't. I've lost some people for different reasons, but I am, you know, for the most part, just hanging tight. I think I have not experience with this, but I have experience with waiting in my life. You know, it's like, you know, I haven't really been given everything right away. Like, you know, especially in the whole thing about, like, you know, music, whatever. I feel worse for people that were like, you know, like artists that were brand new, that were like just about to like kind of drop their shit, you know, or like kind of were like on the like precipice of like getting. I feel like I was able to get a foothold a bit before this happened. And so, you know, I'm grateful for that. You could like, you know, this is the kind of thing that you could miss a whole shot. And that's it's awful to think about that, you know, I just feel like I'm just aware of that kind of stuff. So I think, you know, I've been like kind of nonstop creative since this happened. I've been like writing a lot, and just being able to spend a lot more time on my record, because I was going to be doing a lot of stuff from abroad, you know, and back and forth and all this stuff. And I'm just I'm going to be prepared when I get out. That's what I feel like. One of the things that like really helped me to write songs, even when I'm not quote unquote inspired, you know, when I was like, you know, just writing songs for other people as a job, that was like the only, like, you know, that was how I was making a living. They're not being for myself, and had to come up with ideas constantly to write. There was no like kind of like, oh, you poor artist, you know, like go see a movie and relax, don't worry, if you're not inspired, it's okay, we'll do it tomorrow, you know. When you're a writer, they're like, you better have a song done by then to today, because we need songs. And they didn't really care, and it wasn't like, you know, and if you were like coming out of sessions with no song done, you weren't like going to be that sought after as a songwriter. So I feel like I got very used to just like writing through. Maybe it wasn't like a great song every time, but like, you know, just other things, just like keep output, felt like that was the way to get to other songs, you know. Sometimes a song, I could see songs, I've said this stuff before in interviews, but I could see songs that are stepping stones to other bigger songs. I was just on the road a lot, so I would kind of like have my producer come out or whatever, or like, you know, my producer, another, you know, co-writer or something like that, come out and meet me on the road. We did some of this record in Greece as well. I had a week in between shows, and it wasn't really like gonna be hours effective if I went all the way home and all the way back. So I stayed in Greece and got all this great shit. And then I was like, you know, like I really feel inspired when I'm in different areas. And I knew this already. We'd written like When We're High in Paris on like one day off in the middle of a tour. And I just kept seeing evidence that I liked being in different environments. So I went to Cabo in Mexico for 10 days or something like that. And the El Gonzo Hotel. The studio was super dope, but it was like down under the bar in the basement and really cool. We went there a couple of times, but we basically set up our studio in the room upstairs in one of the big rooms. And I don't know, we banged out literally 8 songs. I don't know if all of them will make it, but this was the third song we wrote. I don't know, it just felt special like right away, but they all are feeling rather special. But I think this one just felt like, I don't know, it just felt like a good first song. Darren's the creative director right now. Again, he did Heart to Mouth with me, and I feel really comfortable with him. He did the Girls Go Wild video and stuff, and I just felt really like I wanted to kind of, I feel like when I have success with somebody, or like I feel like I did, or I felt good about it, I like to try it again, see where we're going, you know? And he just got he was great to get this video done at this time, especially. Not only from his talent, but like the fact that it was one of the, I wouldn't say the first, because I don't know who else did it, but it was it was a few weeks ago and nobody was making videos really. And it wasn't a great time to, be hiring people and to have to deal with the distancing and everything. So we did it all in one afternoon, and I'm in this beautiful landscape. And then there's 20 people around me with masks, it's it was very surreal, it wasn't because I mean, even without masks, it's weird to be kind of acting and you're alone on the prairie, here I am. But it's just interesting time, you had to be done very, very by the book and everything. But I think Darren really filmed the hell out of it, and it looks beautiful. I think I might not have even done this with my life if I really saw all the competition. You know what I mean? Thank God we have the technology to see this and do this. This whole thing, can you imagine the 70s, people not being able to tour or anything, and people wow. This is before videos and everything, people would be like, are they alive? I hope they're alive. They'd be scanning Rolling Stone to see if, fucking Robert Plant was still alive, I was like, fuck. It's pretty crazy that I can go on Instagram Live and literally pick fans to talk to and be like, yo, what's that? It's crazy, I'm in your living room. I'm talking to you directly in your living room. If I could have talked to Jeff Buckley face to face on Instagram, whatever that was back in the day, I would have been like, holy shit, look at these Zoom calls. I mean, Zoom is the way of life. I mean, even, even the business that is going on, I know a lot of business has been halted, but man. I mean, it's real, and it's not going away, and it's something that we have to chip away at every day to try to undo everything that's been done, and, kind of dismantle so much that's there, and then kind of build a new way of thinking about things and a new way of acting on things. And we have all these people that don't want that, so we're in it right now. In my lifetime, this is as intense as it's got, and it needs to. I mean, we can't keep going like this. We can't move forward as a society without people without equality.